So this is the obligatory block diagram for CometCloud. It basically consists of four layers. We have the infrastructure layer at the bottom, and essentially what this has is an overlay, a dynamic self-organizing overlay which connects these different resources that you need. And this basically allows you to add new resource types or resource providers into your overlay and remove ones that you don't need. It can very robustly be able to deal with resources disconnecting or failing, right? And so it allows you to create a custom federated structure consisting of the resources that you're interested in, right? On top of this is a content-based routing layer which can allow you to address resources using attributes rather than specific addresses. So it allows you to say that I want to route this job to a resource with certain characteristics. And then on top of that, we have services for example, data replication services for load balancing and a bunch of other things, notification, propagating events, and things like that that build on that, right? On top of this, we have built a bunch of services for running our applications. You have a coordination service which allows you to run workflows to coordinate executions and to be able to just manage the overall application execution. You have a discovery service which allows me to see is there a resource that exists that meets my requirements? Do I need to federate other resources in there? So gives you the basic discovery services. We have some messaging services that allow you to propagate events and allow these different applications or workflows to communicate with each other. And then we have some management services that do system management, allow you to be more proactive in managing your infrastructure, in being able to schedule your tasks. And these are based on more distributed clustering type algorithms that are implemented on this that allow you to find, for example, find out what systems are doing and how to adapt your scheduling policies, all right, or what your job queues are doing and be able to provision more resources accordingly. So because autonomics is a big part of what we're doing, having these kind of services at the core level become very important. And so moving on to autonomic management, we have a autonomic manager that allows us to to manage both the resources and applications of our federated infrastructure, to be able to provision resources as needed, to be able to adapt the scheduling and mapping of resources, jobs to resources, to be able to meet constraints that that are needed prescribed by the system and or the application. And on top of that, we have also built a bunch of programming models. We have a master worker bag of task models. We have a workflow type model. We have a map reduce type model. And we're looking at other programming models that might be meaningful here. We're also looking at interesting platforms which are more semantically specialized to certain application classes and exposing them as a way or an easier way for applications or scientists to build their applications. So I wanted to expand a little more on the autonomics in CometCloud. Essentially, what this does is provide managers at different levels. At the lowest level, we have a local resource agent, right? So a greater cloud or a cluster agent, which understands the capabilities and degrees of adaptivity that exist in that infrastructure. For example, certain infrastructure may allow me to add resources or remove resources or change a configuration of a resources or change, for example, the power mode of the resources, the operational modes, right? And so it understands what are the the different degrees or knobs that our infrastructure provides, and is able to, based on requests coming in from the managers, tweak these controls appropriately so that it you can meet the objectives, right? At the adaptivity manager, this really based on policies coming out from the overall manager, is able to decide what knobs a different agent should be turning to be able to meet the needs and objectives and constraints that have been prescribed by the system or by the application. And finally, the overall manager looks at the objectives that the application workflow provides and tries to make high-level decisions that are then executed by the adaptivity manager and the agents at a lower level, right? And so this happens in sort of a continuous way where there's a continuous monitoring that goes on of individual resources, as well as aggregate monitoring using these clustering techniques that allow you to create, understand trends, and be able to do some amount of cluster tracking and cluster prediction that can sort of anticipate what workloads are going to do or system queues are doing, right, in the next time epoch, and then be able to proactively manage your provisioning or your resource configurations accordingly. So we monitor these things, come up with the analysis, and then define certain adaptations and behaviors for the agents at a low level, which allow you to then make the appropriate adaptations. And we have a bunch of case studies that we have done using this that have been published at various venues. So this this slide essentially goes into a little more detail about this, the at different layers of the stack. So at the infrastructure layer, we have the ability to scale out, to be able to react to failures or to data loss at that level. And we have ability to handle infrastructure leaving or joining the system to support different type of data boundaries that one might establish. And we have ability to adapt the system or the infrastructure layer based on these constraints. At the service layer, we have the ability to support monitoring, as I mentioned, and to be able to adapt the service behaviors based on application or system context or requirements. At the autonomic layer, we provide resource provisioning based on user objectives. The idea here is to, again, do some amount of estimation of resource requirements of application behaviors using cluster prediction, using some sort of learning mechanisms, and then to react to those accordingly, and to adjust resource provisioning or resource configuration based on these aspects. And finally, at the application layer, one can then have very dynamic workflows. One can support policy-based adaptations, compositions, and based on things like, as I mentioned, runtime throughput constraints, budgets, and other such constraints.